While no single conversation is guaranteed to change everything, any single conversation can. One of the many memorable quotes from Susan Scott's book, Fierce Conversations. Susan Scott describes a fierce conversation as a dialogue that is robust, intense, strong, powerful, passionate, eager, and unbridled. For some, that's the only conversation they know how to have. It's always intense and passionate and exhausting for the rest of us.
Yep, it can be.
For others, they avoid conversations like that at all costs. Going deeper really isn't their intention or desire. They prefer to stay safe in the shallow end.
Are you tired of small groups always getting into your business? Trying to get you to share your feelings, discuss your past, confess your sins? Are you just looking for a place to kick it, network, maybe get some free grub? Me too. That's why I created what I believe to be the world's first openly shallow small group. We're not here to deal with messy stuff like feelings and emotions. You got problems? You deal with them. You're an adult. Life ain't easy. So stop the pity party. We all have our issues. We don't really want to do life together. Frankly, at Shallow Small Group, we try not to do much of anything at all. You'll never hear us use the term unpack that thought. We're sure it's packed away for a really good reason. And you'll never hear us use the term accountability unless you're talking about someone who deals with numbers. Hey dude, thanks for doing my taxes. You have great accountability. And spiritual growth? Who wants growth? I had a growth removed last week. It wasn't pleasant. There's no pressure here to remember each other's name.
What's going, buddy?
Oh, hey man, how's it going?
That's good.
Yeah, hey, good. Oh, dude.
Captain, what's going on?
We know you have a name, and that's the important thing. Group discussion? You got tickets to the big game? Sweet. Let's spend some time on that. Oh, you and your wife are struggling financially? There's tension in the relationship? That's not really the vibe we're going for. We avoid conflict like the plague.
Who wants cake? Come on and get it!
And there will never, ever be an awkward silence. That's our guarantee to you. We hate bad theology as much as the next guy, and we know the surest way to prevent bad theology is to avoid theology altogether. And outreach? This is the only outreach you'll ever have to do. Some people say we're superficial, but hey, the word super isn't superficial. I mean, who doesn't want to be super? Shallow small group, because when things get too deep, people drown. Won't you join us?
So watching that video, does that make you want to be in that group? No, I don't think so. We actually do want to talk below the surface. We want to talk about things that matter. And it's those good conversations that get below the surface that really invigorate us and help us to live in alignment. So Susan Scott, in her book, The Fierce Conversations, really good book on this whole matter. We've asked you to read this book, and we want to work through some of the highlights of it with you here. So as you know from reading the book, there are seven principles here in her way of looking at fierce conversations. And the first one is mastering the courage to interrogate reality. Now, this means getting a conversation below the surface. We're getting down into the areas where we're actually finding out what people think and feel. And it can be a little scary because you're not sure what people are thinking and feeling, and it may be even scary for you. So the first thing she says we got to do here is we need to interrogate reality with ourselves. In fact, if you turn in your book here to page 55, there's a really good one here about your core values. Now, this is where you can go back to course number 2, pull up your core values, remind yourself what you said was really important to you, and then run an integrity check. And here's what she says. Is my behavior out of alignment with these values? Am I acting like this in my workplace or in my personal relationships or maybe life in general? And then on page 56 of the book, She gives you a couple of really good questions to help you interrogate reality in your life. You know, what do I have to do to clean this up if there's some outages here? What am I going to do about this? And so that's integrity issue number one is learn how to really check deep within you about how are you actually doing on this stuff.
Right. So the conversation really is with yourself first in order to get down to what the truth really is.
Yep.
And and that's, again, being self-aware. And so what she's saying is having those serious conversations with ourselves. And, you know, a lot of life change happens from those kinds of conversations with ourselves. So, yeah, excellent. Principle number two is then come out from behind yourself into the conversation and make it real. So she has the picture here of wearing a mask, come from behind that, come out in front of the mask that you tend to wear and make your conversations real. Scott writes that when the conversation is real, the change occurs before the conversation is over. So being real is just that powerful. Everyone wants to hear from people who are real. They don't have to be polished or perfect, but if they're real, then you got their attention. So be yourself and bring your natural conversation strengths to the table. Everyone has conversation strengths. These are the things that you're good at when you're talking to people. It may be listening or asking questions, eye contact. You know, if you think of certain people in your mind, when you're talking with them, you notice that about them. They're looking straight at you, or they're listening, or they ask questions, and you feel like, man, they're engaged with me right now, and that helps you engage back. Are those things that you're good at? We want you to identify some of those. So on page 44 in your curriculum, you can write down some of your conversation strengths. You can even give yourself a grade on them if you like, to identify the ones that you're doing well with and maybe some of the ones you want to work on. But we'd like you to do that right now. So why don't you just pause the video and go to page 44 in your curriculum and just spend a moment and do that right now.
And now, principle three, be here, prepared to be nowhere else. And this is this whole thing of giving focused attention to this conversation. If we want to have good conversations, we've got to be focused right there with this person and not be thinking and living another life simultaneously. On page 45 of our curriculum, there's a couple of charts that help you understand what it means to be present. So we want to give you those two charts to work through. So go ahead and look at your curriculum of being present. And then the second one, please don't. And just do a bit of a self-evaluation. Are you fully prepared to be here? Fully in your whole being.
All right, these little checklists along the way hopefully are going to be helpful for you for these principles to sink down a bit. And these come right out of her book. So principle number four is tackle your toughest challenge today. Scott states that what's on the other side of your toughest issue is worth it. For example, on the other side of a real tough issue for you, maybe relief or health or freedom, happiness, fulfillment, those all can come after a challenge. So what is she getting at with this point? Basically, don't put off difficult conversations. They'll eat away at you. We will introduce you later to a process for leading groups through a fierce conversation to help someone deal with a tough issue. And it's called Slaying Alligators. And an alligator is just those issues that keep biting at you. And you can take care of those as a group. We'll show you how. For now, identify some of those tough conversations that you know you need to have. And you can do that on page 46.
And then principle number 5, Scott says, obey your instincts. She so correctly points out that there's always two conversations going on simultaneously. There's one that's in your mind and invisible to everybody else. And then there's the other one that you're having with people outside. So these two are happening simultaneously, and we need to be very aware of what's actually going on. And this is where we need to understand the difference between these two conversations and making sure that we're not getting too far apart on them. She talks about a left-hand column, meaning these are what you're thinking and feeling in your mind. And then there's the right-hand column, which is that's what you're saying and making visible to other people. And those two things are happening simultaneously. And we need to be making sure that these are not too far apart. Because if you're thinking and feeling a whole set of things and you're not saying that, now you have a lack of integrity.
Yeah.
So then how do you bring it up? Well, here's a suggestion. In between the left-hand column, which is what we're saying is what you are thinking and feeling in your gut, and then what you're actually saying out here or what the other person is saying, there's a space in between here that we could put in what we call the neutral zone, where it's a perception check. And here's a helpful way to say it. You know, if you're thinking something and the other person, you wonder what that person thinks about it, you can say something like, you know, I've been wondering, what do you think about this? And you just kind of put it into the middle zone here. You're not saying this is the truth or this is the way it is. You're saying, I'm wondering about this. What do you think? And you're inviting them to speak into it. That's one way to bring up something that's emotionally maybe kind of dangerous, you think. But if you bring it up in a neutral way, not to say it's the truth, but it's a way to say, what do you think about that? I'm thinking and wondering about this. What do you think? And when they speak into it, it might be a way to have them to say, well, actually, I was thinking the same thing, but I was afraid to say it. Yeah. Or it could be that they say something that changes your whole mind. You realize, oh, good grief, I was wrong. And you can abandon this feeling and thought you had here in the middle. So there's a gut instinct thing that you're thinking and feeling that needs to be checked and somehow brought into this conversation. And that's one way to do it.
The next one is, you know, as conversations happen, sometimes emotions get involved. And the principle 6 is take responsibility for your emotional wake. Long after people have forgotten the content of the conversation, they'll still remember the emotion of it, especially if the conversation is a significant one, like we are describing. Those emotions usually manifest themselves in the form of flight or fight. They are natural reactions, but we need to own them and deal with the consequences. If we tend to take off, or we tend to dig in, we have to own the consequences of both those reactions. So while we're thinking about that, here's a question. Can fight be your tendency and do it without anger?
The answer would need to be yes. Is there a way to be real without damaging people?
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I think you can. This is where Jesus said he was full of grace and truth.
Yeah. Yeah, wow. So fighting doesn't have to be vicious.
No.
And so maybe fight is a term there that doesn't quite explain it well, but we're used to those terms of fight and flight. So, yeah. But it doesn't have to be vicious. It may be simply standing your ground and doing it in a respectful way. So take a look at pages 48 and 49. They talk about this fight and flight tendencies. Maybe just go through the checklist now and just see what your tendency might be. And you can pause the video and start it again when you're ready.
And now we come to principle number 7. Let silence do the heavy lifting. This is a really good one. I remember the first time I read it, I thought, wow, that is a very good idea. Because we tend to want to fill in the silence with something. And we talk. When actually, by pausing and let silence just hang in the air, it gives space and time for some deep thinking to happen. Now, boy, we often do not allow silence into our conversation, which means it can't go real deep. But here on page 49, here are some examples of when it could be indicating you need to actually let silence be there. So here's what I've observed. Some people ask a good question, and then there's a silence, and then they reinterpret the question. They say it again, and they actually ruin the silence.
That's
like,
right.
Just leave it. Get the question and leave it.
Yeah, or they leave half a second for a response because they are comfortable with the silence.
Really good. Let silence do the heavy lifting.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So we're going to continue now with the theme of robust conversations. We're going to talk about how to have a really good conversation with yourself. And then a way to have a whole group have this kind of in-depth conversation. These are fascinating two tools that you will use the rest of your life.
Hmm.